This episode is sponsored by Surfshark. Will Super Heavy land? Will the suborbital Starship pads burn? What's SpaceX's plan for Super Heavy landings? What's the result of the latest Starship cryo tests? When can we expect the static fire? And what happens when a Starship sneezes? Let's find out.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. SpaceX's Starship is drawing the attention of the spaceflight community more and more, and rightfully so. The project could, if successful, revolutionize the way we access space, and it might even make us a multiplanetary species. And we're testing. As predicted in the last episode, SpaceX has started testing Starship 20 in preparations for a static fire. We're getting closer and closer to a possible first orbital flight. This cryogenic test used liquid nitrogen. LNG is used to simulate cryogenic fuel. It has about the same temperature, it can be used to build up the same pressure, and this way SpaceX can make sure that the construction is safe to use and that it can withstand the pressure needed for a flight. All that without risking a devastating explosion if something goes wrong. Liquid nitrogen is inert, it's not flammable. What can happen if real propellant is used and something goes wrong can be seen here. It's Starship prototype SN4, and Tim Dodd, the everyday astronaut, got the best pictures of what arguably was the most powerful explosion at the Starbase launch site yet. A fuel disconnect failed after a successful static fire of a Raptor engine. The explosion was so powerful that you could even see the shockwave propagating upwards through the atmosphere. And this had only enough fuel in it for one static fire. If they'd fully fuel a Starship and something went wrong, the result would be much more powerful. So it's a wise decision to use liquid nitrogen for these cryogenic tests. And closely studying the footage, everything looked great. The test candidate likely reached flight pressure and there were no visible problems. Quite the opposite, actually. Some impressive venting could be seen as well. It's always a pleasure to see a Starship come alive for such a test. It's a reminder that this is real and that these prototypes don't just look good, they also work as intended. Next up, we have the static fire. It's unclear right now how many Raptors will be ignited, but we'll likely at least see all three C-level engines be test-fired. The booster will likely be tested at the orbital launch mount, as the suborbital pads might not be suited for a 28 Raptor engine static fire, which would need to be done before a Super Heavy launch. A Super Heavy static fire would likely burn up the suborbital pads and cause heavy damage. Maybe even to the booster itself. The orbital pad is not ready yet, though. And Orbital Fuel Farm 1, which would be needed for a cryogenic test and a static fire at the orbital launch mount, isn't ready either. But we're getting closer and closer every day. A load spreader and a crane have been attached to the GSE cryo shell recently. It's the one tank that's still missing, and it will complete the GSE tank setup once it's delivered to the launch site. Another sign for the orbital fuel farm approaching usability is a recent venting activity on one of the LOX tanks and constant liquid nitrogen deliveries to the fuel farm. Sometimes the setup of the orbital fuel farm can be really confusing. The Denks on Twitter has made the most complete diagram of the orbital fuel farm yet. It's really geeky stuff, but I do know that there are some in the Y community who, like me, love the geeky details. I'm not going to explain the diagram in depth, but I did want to spread the word about it. In the credits section of this episode, there is a direct link to the Denks Twitter account. Go check it out for the diagram if you want to go really deep into how the orbital fuel farm works in detail. There are constant reminders, though, that the Starship test program is just that, a test program. On October 27th, this could be observed on the Lab Padre livestream. It's Starship 20 sneezing. And something can be seen falling down. No, it's not snot. Right next to a worker passing by, those are TPS heat tiles. And they fell down from the nose cone of Starship 20. A slight noise could be heard too. Elon Musk responded to a short clip posted by Lewis from Lab Padre and gave some more information. The header tank vent knocked off a few tiles. Lewis, our photographer, was on site a few hours after it happened and took these pictures for us. They show the aftermath of the Starship's sneeze and the missing heat tiles that fell down. In daylight, the damage can be spotted even better. This picture was taken on the morning after the incident. The header tank vent can be seen too, and it aims directly at the edge of the heat shield. The vent must have been able to move the edge of the first few tiles, and then it was able to blow under them and rip them off from Starship 20's hull. The damage is not bad, and the fix will likely be easy, but it opens up a few questions. Looking at a picture of the nose cone from a day before the incident shows the edge of the heat shield intact. It's not smooth at all, and air does have an attack point here. It's not much, but a strong blast can use this 90 degree angle to inflict force directly on the tiles. The vent is an easy fix, just point it away from the tiles. But what about the general durability of the heat shield? If a header tank vent can blow off some tiles, what will the force of an orbital re-entry do to the heat shield? Does it need a better attachment method? Likely. What's really important here is that you shouldn't forget one fundamental fact when you're looking at these Starship prototypes. It's a prototype. It's under active development, and most of what you see here is not the final product. What you're looking at here is a video made by Trevor Malman, an accomplished launch photographer whom you should follow on Twitter if you're not yet doing so. He was able to catch a video of CRS-23's Cargo Dragon re-entering Earth's atmosphere on October 1st. Besides this being the final part of a perfect mission execution by SpaceX to resupply the International Space Station once more, it also shows how much force is involved when an object comes down to Earth again from orbit. This is what a Starship will have to endure as well. And likely, Starship 20's heat shield might not be able to do this. Musk has stated before that the first few Starships will likely not make it back down, either by failing to reach orbit or by not making it through the critical phase of re-entry, prototyping. And there's always something new. My friend Marcus House, whose channel you should watch if you're not, recently published an exciting idea. These pictures taken by Starship Gazer show a strange thin hull of some sort inside the high bay. SpaceX has been working on it right next to Booster 5. Marcus's theory is that it might be an internal tank for Booster 5, which will hold fuel for a boost back and landing burn. Musk has stated before that Super Heavy boosters will need a separate tank for those maneuvers. Likely because the main tanks are much larger than on a Falcon 9 booster, which doesn't require individual tanks for this. Sloshing would be much harder to control inside such a large main tank. SpaceX workers have recently lowered the already stacked Booster 5 hull onto this smaller tube, solidifying the theory of a header tank. Now, Mary from NASA Spaceflight has taken this picture. It shows a small diameter segment, apparently with 32 holes in it. It could be a part of just that header tank. Marcus depicted the tank as being inside the booster and on the side of the hull. What if SpaceX integrates the header tank around the central downcomer in the middle of the booster? In this case, the weight wouldn't be asymmetric and SpaceX would have a much more centered design. Booster 5 with header tanks, of course, also means that Booster 4's successor might already attempt a landing in Boca Chica. What do you think? Is this part of the Super Heavy header tank? And if so, would it be built around the central fuel downcomer inside the LOX tanks? As always, tell me in the comments. Next up, we'll talk Booster 5 and Ship 21 progress, and we'll take a look at possible upcoming test dates. Stay tuned. The Y family needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe, and share it with your friends on Twitter or Facebook to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Looking for a more direct way of support? Become a Patreon or YouTube member by clicking the join button right under the video and get some awesome perks. Gain access to our Discord server where you can meet me and the rest of the community or get a completely ad-free release of each and every episode provided just for channel members. Or do you know about the Y Warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt, hoodie or cap and look as awesome as you feel. Links can be found in the description. You rock. So Starship 20 is in full test mode by now, getting ready for a static fire, and Booster 4 is still waiting for the orbital launch mount to be ready for first tests. Progress, progress, progress. But we're talking SpaceX, and the Starship program maybe is the fastest moving rocket development program of all times. This is the construction site of SpaceX's Starbase, as seen from Mauricio's point of view on his last flyby. Make sure to check out his YouTube channel, his Twitter, and his Patreon page. Links can be found in the description. And there are some things that can only be seen from the bird's eye view, like the progress on the super high bay that's under construction right now. And SpaceX is quick with the build, to say the least. The foundation, made up of several layers of heavily reinforced concrete, is almost ready by now, and anchor points for pillars can already be seen. SpaceX is building this additional high bay to accommodate the prototype build speed we can look forward to next year. SpaceX will need to speed up development and go different paths as well. A lunar starship is different from a regular one, so sooner or later SpaceX will need more prototypes and faster. While on the ground, Mauricio was able to take this picture of a freshly delivered booster grid fin. It likely is for booster 5, which is steadily growing inside the high bay and should be fully stacked within the next week or two. Here's a question I've heard a few times when showing pictures of booster 4. This one was taken right after the booster got taken down from the orbital launch mount to make room for Mechazilla construction. Do you see those COPVs? They are covered with plastic bags, and that, of course, is not final. Starship Gazer was able to take some awesome pictures of what will be the replacement for the plastic bags. You're looking at a booster aft aero cover, and there are several of them on site already. They look crude, as always, when SpaceX introduces something for the first time on the Starship program. Likely not the final design, but they'll do the job. These covers will be placed on top of the COPVs, heat exchangers, and other hardware positioned on the outside of Booster 4's aft section once work is done on the parts. And they will give the protection needed on ascent. Thank you, Starship Gazer, for these awesome pictures. Make sure to check out his Twitter account. A link is in the credit section. Alex Swan has recently released a new animation depicting a Starship orbital launch compared to a Falcon Heavy. Besides it being an incredible animation again, it also shows one crucial aspect about SpaceX you might not immediately see: Falcon Heavy's brand new rocket tech. February 6th of 2018, that's when Falcon Heavy had its maiden flight, a bit more than 3.5 years. For a rocket, that's nothing. Rockets like Soyuz have been in service for decades, and that's normal. At least it was until SpaceX entered the market. Now, a Falcon Heavy, arguably the king of operational rockets right now, is already almost outdated after a few years of service. SpaceX's only real competitor right now is SpaceX, and that after only 19 years of company history. Musk and his team are breaking records with everything they do. As a final for today's episode, let's have a look at when we can see the next Starship tests and the next records being broken. As of recording this episode, we have new road closures for October 7th, 8th, and 11th. Yet another sign for SpaceX ramping up the testing again. According to the closure times, Thursday might just be what we're looking for. Highway 4 will be closed from 5 p.m. local time to midnight. Since the thrust rams have been taken out under Starship 20 after the recent cryogenic test, the next one will likely be the static fire, and this could be it. If the first test date isn't enough, we have two more secondary test dates on October 8th and 11th. Let's keep our fingers crossed for an excellent static fire and a clean engine test for Starship 20. This would be the next major milestone needed on the road to the orbital launch. Then it all depends on Booster 4. Now let's have a look at today's sponsor, and don't click away just yet. The deal is actually pretty sweet. Whether it's data and identity theft, traceability, intrusive advertising, or geo-blocking, Surfshark VPN encrypts your data and enables you to change your virtual location. Have you ever been greeted with the message that this site or video is not available in your country? Streaming services like Netflix or Disney Plus, for example, have vastly different libraries in different countries. Surfshark makes you outsmart them easily by removing the so-called geo-block from your account. Just activate your VPN, change your virtual location, refresh the page, and you're good to go for countless more Netflix evenings. Use my code to get 83% off plus 3 extra months for free, and at the same time support What About It. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there is no risk. Surf with your own set of rules, links in the description. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Luna Depression, Chris Craven, John Rose, Jeremy Schmidt, Keith Clement, B. Victor Kovac, Pseudonym, and many others. You rock so incredibly much. Without you and countless others, we wouldn't even produce the content, so the entire team's gratitude is yours. Make sure to hop on our supporter-exclusive Discord to join more than 1,000 spaceflight enthusiasts and to give me the chance to thank you in person. Today's team shoutout goes to the website team, which is in the final steps of getting a prototype ready for review. Diane, Sunny, Timo, Heisi, and anyone else I might have forgotten. You've done something I wouldn't have thought to be possible as an entirely voluntary project. I cannot wait to have the community see what you've accomplished, and it makes me incredibly proud to be a part of such an incredible community. You rock. When can we expect the Static Fire? And when do we burp? I'll do the thing again. The danks.
Shall we play a game?
That was my computer. And.
Yay.
Yay.
Danks. Hey, we're done.